Good morning, students. In the previous class, we have covered propagation of waves in good conductors and solved an example on it. Let us continue with solving few more examples on propagation of waves in good conductors. Calculate intrinsic impedance eta, the propagation constant gamma, and wave velocity v for a conducting medium in which sigma is equal to 58 mega Siemen per meter. This conductivity mu r is equal to 1, epsilon r is equal to 1 at a frequency of 100 megahertz. For conducting medium, sigma is given, so they have given the value of sigma 58 mega Siemen per meter. Let us use the expression of eta, gamma, and velocity for good conductors. So the intrinsic impedance eta for good conductors is given by eta is equal to square root of j omega mu divided by sigma. So this is equal to square root of, this is equal to square root of j 2 pi f, mu is mu naught mu r, this divided by sigma. This will be equal to square root of 2 pi into 100 into 10 raised to 6, f is 100 megahertz, 100 into 10 raised to 6 into mu naught is 4 pi into 10 raised to minus 7, mu r is 1, this divided by sigma. Sigma is 58 into 10 raised to 6, so this value of root j is angle 90 degrees. So if we simplify this term, right, square root of angle 90 degrees, we know that it is angle 45 degree, right? We have already done that in our previous classes. And if we simplify this term, so this entire term, if we simplify, right, we get this is equal to 3.6896 into 10 raised to minus 3, 3.6896 into 10 raised to minus 3 at an angle of 45 degree ohm, because it is right. So what we are getting here, so here if we simplify this term, right, so the answer will be equal to, the answer will be equal to, the answer will be equal to here, okay, so that is 3.6896 into 10 raised to minus 3 at an angle of 45 degree ohm. So this is nothing but the intrinsic impedance eta, intrinsic impedance eta, right. Propagation constant gamma, propagation constant gamma is given by square root of j omega mu sigma, square root of j omega mu sigma for good conductors, right. So that is, this is equal to square root of omega is 2 pi f, this into mu is mu naught mu r, this into sigma at an angle 90 degree. Angle 90 degree because root j is angle 90 degree. So if we simplify this, then we get, that is, this is equal to square root of 2 pi into 100 into 10 raised to 6 into 4 pi into 10 raised to minus 7, this into mu r is 1, sigma is this into 58 into 10 raised to 6 at an angle of 90 degrees. This comes out to 2.1399 into 10 raised to 5 into 10 raised to 5 at an angle of 45 degrees. At an angle of 45 degrees. So this is the value of propagation constant. This is the value of propagation constant gamma. Fine. So now this is in polar form. If we convert from polar form to Cartesian form, I have explained how to convert from polar to Cartesian, right? So if we convert from polar to Cartesian, then this we get, this is equal to gamma, it is a complex number, alpha plus j beta. So this is equal to 1.5131 into 10 raised to 5, right, plus j 1.5131 into 10 raised to 5. This is the complex number. Correct. Now if we compare the real and imaginary terms, we get, so if we compare this equation with this equation, so we get alpha is equal to 1.5131 into 10 raised to 5 Napier per meter. Fine. And what about beta? Beta is equal to 1.5131. Beta is this imaginary term into 10 raised to 5. What is the unit of beta? Radians per meter. Yes or no? Next, let us calculate velocity of propagation. Velocity of propagation v is given by omega by beta. We know the value of omega, that is 2 pi f. This divided by beta. So this is equal to 2 pi into f is 100 into 10 raised to 6. This divided by beta is 1.5131. Just now we calculated this into 10 raised to 5. So this is equal to 4.152 into 10 raised to 3 meter per second. That is the value of velocity. So fine students, let us take up one more example. Next example. So next example is like this. Determine the skin depth. Determine the skin depth for copper with conductivity of 58 into 10 raised to 6 Siemens per meter at a frequency of 10 megahertz. So what is given here? They have asked to find out the skin depth. Determine the skin depth. That means you have to find the value of delta. Right? Conductivity is given. Sigma is 58 into 10 raised to 6. Frequency is given. F is 10 megahertz. Formula for delta. Assuming mu r is equal to minus 1, assuming mu r is equal to 1, relative permeability as 1. So delta formula is 1 upon square root of, for good conductor, copper, delta is given by 1 upon square root of pi f mu sigma. So this will be equal to 1 upon square root of pi f mu naught mu r into sigma. Pi f, 1 upon square root of pi f mu naught mu r sigma. This comes out to 1 over square root of pi into f is 10 into 10 raised to 6 is 10 megahertz frequency. This into mu naught is 4 pi into 10 raised to minus 7. Mu r, assume it as 1. This into sigma is 58 into 10 raised to 6. Therefore, on simplification, we get the value of skin depth. That is delta is equal to 20.898. This into 10 raised to minus 6 meters. Or that is equal to 20.898 micrometer. Okay. So this is how we are calculating the value of skin depth. Let us move on to one more example. Wet marshy soil is characterized by wet marshy soil is characterized by sigma is equal to 10 raised to minus 2 siemen per meter, epsilon r is equal to 15, and mu r is equal to 1. Mu r is equal to 1 at frequencies sixty hertz, 1 megahertz, 100 megahertz, and 10 gigahertz, and 10 gigahertz indicate whether soil be considered a conductor or a dielectric. For wet marshy soil, what is given? For wet marshy soil, sigma is equal to 10 raised to minus 2 siemen per meter, epsilon r is equal to 15, mu r is equal to 1. Now, at f is equal to 60 hertz, at frequency is equal to 60 hertz, value of sigma upon omega epsilon, that is sigma divided by 2 pi f into epsilon naught epsilon r. This is equal to 10 raised to minus 2, this divided by 2 pi into 60 into 8.854 into 10 raised to minus 12 into 15. Epsilon r is 15. So this will be equal to 1.9972 into 10 raised to 5. So this value is very, very larger than 1. Correct? So this value sigma upon omega epsilon is 1.9972 into 10 raised to 5, which is very, very larger than 1. So as the value of this ratio is very high compared to 1, compared to unity, so the wet marshy soil acts as a conductor. So as sigma upon omega epsilon is very, very larger than 1, the wet marshy soil acts as conductor at 60 hertz. Okay. Similarly, at f is equal to 1 megahertz. Sigma upon omega epsilon we want. This is equal to sigma divided by 2 pi f into epsilon naught epsilon r. That is 10 raised to minus 2. This divided by 2 pi into 10 raised to 6, this into 8.854 into 10 raised to minus 12, this into 15. Okay. So what has changed here? F value is changed. F is 1 megahertz, that is 10 raised to 6. So the answer is, this is equal to 11.9836, which is also very, very larger than 1. So again, at 1 megahertz, okay, so at 1 megahertz also, the soil acts as conductor. Soil acts as conductor. Next, at F is equal to 100 megahertz. Okay, at F is equal to 100 megahertz. At F is equal to 100 megahertz. At F is equal to 100 megahertz. What we get here? Sigma upon omega epsilon. This comes out to sigma divided by 2 pi F into epsilon naught epsilon R. So this will be equal to 10 raised to minus 2, the whole divided by 2 pi into 100 into 10 raised to 6, 100 into 10 raised to 6 into 8.854 into 10 raised to minus 12, this into 15. So the answer is 0.1198. So this is less than 1, correct? 0.1198 is less than 1. What it indicates, as sigma upon omega epsilon is less than 1. So at F is equal to 100 megahertz, wet marshy soil acts as lossy dielectric, because it is just less than 1. Correct. Next, at F is equal to 100 gigahertz. Okay. So at F is equal to 100 gigahertz. So in the problem, it is given as 10 gigahertz. So make it 100 gigahertz here. So it is 100 gigahertz, not 10 gigahertz, 100 gigahertz. Right. So at F is equal to 100 gigahertz. Let us calculate that. So at F is equal to 100 gigahertz. At F is equal to 100 gigahertz. What is gigahertz? Yes, come on, tell me. 100 gigahertz. So that is 100 into 1 gigahertz is 100 into 10 raised to 9. So 1 gigahertz is 10 raised to 9. So sigma upon omega epsilon, this is equal to sigma divided by 2 pi F into epsilon naught epsilon R. This is equal to 10 raised to minus 2, this divided by 2 pi into 100 into 10 raised to 9, this into 8.854 into 10 raised to minus 12, this into 15. Correct? So what will be the answer here? Yes. So this comes out to 0, that is 119.836 into 10 raised to minus 6. 119.836 into 10 raised to minus 6. So what it indicates here, this is very, very less than 1. So as the answer, that is sigma upon omega epsilon value, is very, very less than 1. So it indicates at F is equal to 100 gigahertz, wet marshy soil acts as perfect dielectric. Okay. So this is all about the numericals on propagation of wave in good conductors. Now let us start with the new module, that is module number 4. It starts with magnetic forces. Here we will be studying the force and torque exerted by the magnetic field on the charges. How much force and torque is exerted by the magnetic field on the charges? That will be studied in this module, right? Let us explain what is the difference between electric field and magnetic field. The electric field exerts force on the stationary charge as well as on the moving charge, whereas the magnetic field exerts the force, right, only on the moving charge, because the magnetic field is established by the moving charge, and hence the force exerted by the magnetic field is only on the moving charge, right? So that is the difference between the force exerted by the electric field and the force exerted by the moving charge. That is a magnetic field. The magnetic field exerts the force only on the moving charge, whereas the electric field exerts the force both on the stationary charge as well as on the moving charge. Clear here? So in this module, we'll also be studying about the magnetic torque and magnetic dipole moments. The first topic, force on a moving point charge. Force on a moving point charge. Moving point charge. Force on a moving point charge. First, let us write the expression for the force exerted by the electric field on the static or on the moving charge Q. Right? So, the force exerted by the electric field on the static charge or on the moving charge is given by Fe bar is equal to Q into E bar newtons. Take it as equation 1. So, this force, if it is exerted on the positive charge, then the direction of this force will be along the direction of the electric field, that is E bar. Next, let us consider the force exerted by the magnetic field on the moving charge. So, the force exerted by the magnetic field on the moving charge, that is the magnetic force, is given by Fm bar. This is equal to Qv bar into B bar. Let us take it as equation 2. So, what is this equation? The force exerted by the magnetic field on the charge which is moving at a velocity V bar, right, with the magnetic field strength B bar, is given by Fm bar is equal to Q into V bar into B bar newtons. So here, if we look into these equations, in the first equation there is no velocity term, right? There is no velocity in the first expression. That means what? The force exerted by the electric field is independent of the velocity of the charge particle. Whereas the force exerted, that is the magnetic force exerted by the magnetic field on the charge, it depends on the velocity of the charge. Depends on the velocity of the charge. Correct? That means the Fm bar, that is the magnetic force, it is proportional to charge. It is proportional to velocity of the charge and also proportional to the magnetic field, and it is also proportional to the angle between the magnetic field and the moving charge. Let us consider here this is the direction of the magnetic field, and let this be the direction of the moving charge. So the angle between the magnetic field and the charge which is moving at a velocity V bar is theta. So if V bar and V bar are in the same plane, then the force exerted, that is the magnetic force exerted, that is the Fm bar, that is equal to Q into V bar into B bar. This will be perpendicular to to the plane containing B bar and B bar. The force exerted, magnetic force exerted on the moving charge, right, will be perpendicular to the plane containing B bar and V bar. If it is the force exerted by the electric field, it does some work. It does some work. But the magnetic force which is exerted on the moving charge, if we want to calculate the work done by this magnetic force, then that is F bar into the displacement of the moving charge, that is dl bar. So what is F bar dot dl bar? So it's a dot product, correct? So we know the expression for how to calculate the dot product, F bar dot dl bar. This is magnitude of F bar. This we have studied in our first module. F bar, magnitude of F bar into magnitude of dl bar into cosine of angle theta between F bar and dl bar. What is the angle between F bar and dl bar? It is 90 degree. So this is F bar into dl bar into cos 90. What is cos 90? Cos 90 is how much? 0. So this comes out to 0. So that is F bar dot dl bar is equal to 0. What it indicates? The magnetic force, right, cannot perform work on a moving charge. Right? There is no work done by the magnetic force, because the product of the force and the displacement, because what is work? Work is force into displacement. The product of force into displacement for the magnetic force is 0. Hence we say that the magnetic force cannot perform work on the moving charge. Okay. This is introduction here. Next, let us write the expression for Lorentz force equation. Lorentz force equation. So if there are two or more forces, the resultant effect is the sum of the effects of all the forces. The resultant effect is sum of the effects of all the forces. Let us consider a particle carrying a charge plus Q and moving with velocity V bar. Let us consider the particle plus Q, carrying charge plus Q and moving with the velocity V bar. This particle is present in a region with both electric and magnetic fields. It is present in a region consisting of both electric and magnetic fields. Then the force exerted on this particle, that is electric force Fe bar and the magnetic force Fm bar, right? They will act on this moving charge, and the total force F bar will be sum of the electric force and the magnetic force. So that is Fe bar, we know that it is Q into E bar, simply Q into E bar. Fm bar, magnetic force, is Q into V bar into B bar. So if we take Q common, so this will be E bar plus V bar into B bar newtons. This equation is called as Lorentz force equation. So this Lorentz force equation, if we see the first term, if we see the first term here, Q into E bar, right, it is not having V term, velocity term. That means the electric force is independent of the velocity. But if we look into the second term, it is Fm bar is Q into V bar into B bar. So it is dependent on the velocity. Right? And the force exerted by the electric force, it is in the direction of E bar, whereas the magnetic force is perpendicular to the plane containing both V bar and B bar. If the mass of the charge is M, this is mass of the charge, then how do we write the force? Force is equal to mass into acceleration, that is M into dV bar by dt, that is nothing but the total force. So it is Q into E bar plus V bar into B bar, newtons. So this is the total force. So what we have here, students, here if the there are few points that we have to take up here. The one is, if the electric field E bar, right, it acts on the stationary charge, then the what will be the force? Q into E bar, right? Q into E bar will be the force exerted by the electric field on the stationary charge. On the moving charge, it is same, Q into E bar only. That is, the force exerted by the electric field on the moving charge is same as the force exerted by the electric field on the stationary charge. Then if it is a magnetic field B bar, magnetic field B bar cannot exert the force on the stationary charge. But so here we can write the expression for the magnetic force on the moving charge. So the magnetic force, that is Fm bar on the moving charge, we know that it is Q into V bar into B bar. Correct? Are you following here, students? Yes. So then combined fields E bar and B bar. If there is a combined field E bar and B bar acting on the stationary charge, so that is, it is nothing but Q into E bar. Because it is stationary charge, there will be no force exerted by the magnetic field. Right? If it is the combined E bar and B bar field on the moving charge, then what will be the total force exerted? It is Q into E bar plus V bar into B bar. Right? So these are few of the points that we can take up here related to the electric fields and the magnetic fields exerted on the stationary and the moving charges. So it is clear from our discussion that the electric force is exerted on a point charge irrespective of whether it is stationary or in motion, but the magnetic force can be exerted only on the moving charge. Right? Then the electric force, it does some work on the charge, on the point charge, right? But the magnetic force cannot do any work, it cannot perform any work on the moving charge. So that we have seen with the equation F bar dot DL bar is equal to 0. So students, I hope everybody have understood the today's topics. We have started with solving the examples on propagation of wave in good conductors, right? We solved few examples, right? Then after solving the examples, we took up module number 4. Module number 4, that is magnetic forces, force on a moving point charge, force on a moving point charge. Then we later explained what is Lorentz force equation, right? Then what will be the electric force and magnetic force on the stationary and moving charges, right? Thank you.